All right, so we start at verse 9, chapter 5. Then the Lord said to Joshua, "This day I have rolled away the reproach of Egypt from you. Therefore, the name of the place is called Gilgal to this day." So I always heard, hey, he's above reproach. That's all. I never heard of just reproach itself. So I had to look it up. And so reproach means disapproval or disappointment. And above reproach actually means no criticism can be made perfect, blameless, without flaw. And we know there ain't but one person that we can say is above reproach, and that's Jesus. God was saying, hey, this day I've rolled away the reproach of Egypt from you. And Gilgal means to roll away. And there's several things here. I noticed that roll away. I was like, wait a minute, roll away. All right, so they rolled away the stone of the tomb, and the only way that we could be above reproach is through Jesus. And Jesus came out, and as long as we follow Jesus and trust in Jesus and are covered by the blood, then in the Father's eyes, we're above reproach. Anything short of that, we're not. And, God's intent, I'm sure, well, we know that is not for the Israelites to become slaves for 436 years. That was a screw up by Joseph's brothers, trying to kill him, being jealous over him. And then therefore, through the different circumstances, the Israelites end up in slavery. So God's saying, hey, I'm taking that shame of slavery away from you. And they fought with that. They were slaves, so, if you're a slave, you really have no, your women can be taken from you, your children, they killed their children, you're beaten, you just have to do what you're told. So there's four generations of people being slaves, and all of a sudden, boom, they usher out into the wilderness, and then God's trying to get this slavery mentality out of them, and it takes basically killing off the first generation, bringing in the second generation when you've got Joshua, a godly man, raising these people up. But it took them that long to get that out of their mentality and of their mind. And they still even wanted to go back. When they were dealing with the manna and they said, hey, we just want to go back, where we had good food. So they were just thinking about, hey, my belly, my stomach, I just want to go back to Egypt so I could get a good meal. I don't understand why, but, in Romans 3:10, speaking of, I believe that's a Bible verse in the School of Discipleship. They went over this past weekend. As it is written, there is no one righteous, not one. So we go down to verse 10. So now the children of Israel camped at Gilgal and kept the Passover on the 14th day of the month at twilight on the plains of Jericho. And as we taught last week, they couldn't participate in the Passover unless they were circumcised. We can go back and look at Leviticus 23, where it talks about the appointed festivals of Passover. We can go to Exodus 12. The Hebrew word for Passover is what? Peshach. Peshach. That's the Hebrew word for Passover. I'm sure y'all know, most of y'all know, with the Passover, how that happened. God was going to kill the firstborn sons of the Egyptians. And God said, hey, go get a spotless lamb. So, Jesus was this, perfect. So you had to get a perfect lamb. And then they were instructed to kill it, put the blood over the doorpost, and the angel of death passed over them and then killed all the firstborn of the Egyptians. And that was the beginning of the Passover. And so now they're able to participate in the Passover again once they're back into the land God promised them, fulfilling that covenant. Leviticus 23:5 is the appointed festival. The Passover began at twilight on the 14th day of the first month. No one can participate in the fat Passover if they were not circumcised. That's Exodus 12:48. And they ate of the produce of the land on the day after the Passover, unleavened bread and parched grain on the very same day. So we know in the Bible, unleavened bread is a picture, unleavened bread is a picture of sin. So they were participating in this unleavened bread, and it mentions unleavened bread in Deuteronomy 16:3, you know, Exodus 12:8, Numbers 9:11. And it talks about, now we can go to Deuteronomy 16:3. Just read that. So you shall eat no leavened bread with it. 7 days you shall eat unleavened bread with it. That is the bread of affliction. For you came out of the land of Egypt, that you may remember the day in which you came out of the land of Egypt all the days of your life. And no leaven shall be seen among you in all your territory for 7 days, nor shall any of the meat which you sacrificed the first day at twilight remain overnight until morning. And this is just coming to my mind, and somebody can help me, maybe Steve. I know that in Israel, when this comes, they get... I think I may have heard Pastor David talk about it. They're getting the bread out of the cracks of their couches, sweeping up the house. They're going to the extreme to get this leavened bread out of the house so they can, you know, obey the commandment. And then I think, too, they do something. They allow other people, I believe, to sell certain things in town. I can't remember exactly what that was, but I know that they just went to the extreme to get every little speck of leaven out of their house, which is a picture of sin. So I'm going to be talking about that at the end, getting the sin, the leaven out of our house, but that's coming toward the end. So verse 12. So the manna ceased on the day after they had eaten the produce of the land. And the children of Israel no longer had manna, but they ate food of the land of Canaan for that year. So imagine growing up and all you're eating is quail and these little teeny tiny pieces. It says that manna is about the coriander seed. All right, and a coriander seed ain't about the size of a pea. So, I was always thinking like leaven was like monkey bread or something. You went around and picked it up. But I did until today, and I looked up about coriander seeds. That's a little teeny tiny thing. So imagine if you got like quarter inch hail, little hailstones. That's what they were out there picking up, little teeny tiny seeds, and 2 quarts is what they could keep in a day. And then, of course, if they kept too much, except on the day before the Sabbath, they could collect the Sabbath's day. But if they kept it longer than a day, it turned rancid. And they actually put, 4 quarts in the Ark of the Covenant? They put some in the Ark of the Covenant. But you can imagine these guys growing up. Well, first of all, they complained. The original people, or the original Israelites that came out, that we're eating the meat and the spices and everything the Egyptians had. And now this is what we get. And again, they're in that slave mentality. And they're like, this is what we get? Are you kidding me? And God's providing them. It also said, let's see here, that in Exodus 16:4, God said, I will rain down bread to test them, to see if they will follow my instructions. And as we know, a lot of them didn't follow God's instructions. And then therefore, a lot of them passed away, or they had to pass away. So you can imagine now they're entered into the land of milk and honey. They already knew it was there because 40 days, they were over there for 40 days and then they came back and messed up, you know, and brought some of the produce from the land of milk and honey. So they already knew it was there. And because, you know, there was only two of them that said, hey, let's go take it. You know, God said, oh, nope. You know, your 40 days has turned into 40 years. And I think Peter 3:8 says, you know, one day is like 1,000 years. To God, you know, in this case, you know, one day is like 40 years. So it's ironic, you know, they were there for 40 days, said no, and then God led them around for 40 years. But now they're back. And, you know, all these kids have grown up eating quail and manna. They don't know any different. You know, and all of a sudden, they're in the land of milk and honey. So, I mean, there's grapes. I mean, all the food that you could possibly think of. And now they're tasting it for the first time. And they didn't have to do anything to get it. It was there. God provided. You know, there's I'm trying to think of that scripture. Matthew 6:26. You know, look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into their barns. And yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? So, you know, they don't have to do anything. And yet they're receiving the benefits of the land because God promised it to them. And here they are just, I mean, I could imagine. I mean, could you imagine tasting a grape for the first time? Or, you know, I mean, you name it. You know, an apple or whatever was over there for the first time. And all you've had was manna, water, and quail. I mean, so just imagine that. I mean, you know how you are when you're hungry or you're thirsty. That's the best tasting glass of water I ever had. Or, man, you go into the grocery store, you know not to go in the grocery store when you're hungry. You know, you'd be buying all kinds of junk. So, you know, good thing the Lord put something in there about gluttony. You know what I mean? Because, I mean, if you think about it, they came out 400 years, they were slaves, they were starved. You know, I mean, nobody's going to feed their slaves great, especially, you know, it sounds like the Egyptians didn't treat them very well, so they were probably about half starving anyway. Then they've got enough, but, you know, obviously they're not walking around like this. You know, there's not any gluttons, I don't think, in the wilderness. So all of a sudden, maybe that becomes a problem eventually. But anyway, so I thought that was neat, that just the Lord provided for them. And it came to pass when Joshua was by Jericho, and this is the coolest part, that he lifted his eyes up and looked, and behold, a man stood opposite to him with his sword drawn in his hand. This was Jesus. All right, Christophany. So there's been several times in the Bible where Jesus has showed up like this. Lots of times you can tell it by certain things. Capital A being one of them. But we know that when you see angels freaking out, don't worship me, bro. And we're getting to that. But he's, you know, when you see somebody say, hey, don't worship me, man, don't worship me, you know that, you know, that's an angel. But God, Jesus, you know, accepts this here in just a second. But could you imagine? So here's Joshua. Joshua's a bad man. I mean, Joshua's killed a lot of people. I mean, this is a man's man. You know, he's got his own sword. So I was sitting there thinking, and I was taking a shower before I came, and I was like, why did Jesus have his sword drawn? You know, it's Jesus. I mean, Jesus had his sword drawn. What was that about? You know, God's omnipresent, omniscient. So you would think that Jesus would know what he was fixing to do. So was Joshua, what if Joshua hadn't asked that question? Because he knew that wasn't one of his people. So, you know, did Joshua have his sword drawn? Was Joshua fixing to go at it? And I thought another thing was cool was, you know, we're created in God's image. So, you know, angels, lots of times when they appear, you know, people freak out because they're big. You know, I mean, they're obviously, fear not. And, you know, Jesus wrestled with Jacob, another Christophany. Jesus wrestled with Jacob. So, if God created us in his image, you know, lots of times we think of, you know, we know angels are big, but angels were created to serve God. So if we were created in God's image, and obviously Jesus came down, he was our size. You know, even in heaven, Is that how he is? You know, when he comes down, is he in heaven? Is God? You know, I mean, obviously we got this flesh, but, you know, in heaven we're spirits. I don't know, you know, necessarily we're going to look like this. But, I mean, obviously Jesus came down to where he didn't, like, whoa, freak out. Like, he was like, hey, are you for us or against us? You know, and I could imagine, I just want to see what Jesus' sword looked like. This thing, maybe it was plain, I don't know, or I'm the Lord of heaven's armies. Maybe this thing was solid gold, had jewels all over it. He was just like shining so bright because of his, you know, his armor. I mean, I don't know. I was like, why did Jesus have his sword drawn, man? That's kind of, I mean, what if Joshua attacked him? You know, I mean, Jesus would have done what he had to do. Because he says right here, you know. His sword drawn, I'll start over. And it came to pass when Joshua was by Jericho that he lifted his eyes and looked, and behold, a man stood opposite him with his sword drawn in his hand. And Joshua went to him and said, are you for us or against us? So he said, no. Man, what? So this is Jesus, that's his people, you know. And Jesus said, nah, I'm not for you. And he's like, what? You know, one version says, I'm neither. That was the one I was studying off of. And he said, no. But I am the commander of the Lord's army. I have now come. And Joshua fell on his face to the earth and worshipped him, saying, what does my Lord say to his servant? The version that I was, it was Jan's study Bible, I was studying off of, said, I'm neither, you know, but I'm commander of the Lord's army. You know, I serve, yeah, I'm neither. I'm free for, I serve the Lord. And if the Lord, you know, basically was saying, hey, if the Lord tells me to cut you down, I'll cut you down. You know, I'm for God. And so, you know, we could say the same thing, you know. Are we for the Lord? You know. No matter, do we take up different sides sometimes? Or are we, you know, for the Lord? That's kind of what I got out of that. And so... You know, Jesus is like, hey, man, I'm for God. I do what God tells me to do. So he said, no, but I am commander of the Lord's army. I have now come. Joshua fell on his face to the earth and worshipped him and said to him, what does my Lord say to his servant? Then the commander of the Lord's army said to Joshua, take your sandals off your feet, for the place where you stand is holy, and Joshua did so. So we see Jesus is a Christophany, which is pre-incarnated of himself. We see him wrestling Jacob, Melchizedek, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. When he's standing like, hey, who's that? You know, Jesus was with him in the fire. And in Revelation 19, 11 through 16. And now I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse. And he who sat on him was called Faithful and True. And in righteousness he judges and makes war. His eyes were like a flame of fire, and on his head were written many crowns, and he had a name written that no one knew except himself. He was clothed with a robe dipped in blood, and his name is the Word of the Lord. All right, so lots of times we think, hey, Jesus is that New Testament Jesus. Yeah, he's the Lamb. But man, he's up there now. He's ready. He's coming back as the Lion. He's coming back as leader of the heavens of armies. And, you know, he's coming back with that sword drawn, the word of God coming out of his mouth. And, you know, I'm looking forward to that day. And all we have to do is trust in Him. And I wrote a song, and it's called "Jesus is a Cowboy." And, he's riding on a horse, and some of the lyrics go like this. He's riding on a white steed. It's toward the end. He's riding on a white steed. He's coming back with heaven's posse. He's got a tattoo on his thigh that no one can deny. He's got a sword in his mouth. His word's going to come out. Yes, he is. Yes, he is a cowboy. He's riding in the sky. He's got fire in his eyes. Trust in him and see, and you can saddle up next to me. He's got a lasso made of flame. When the Lord gave me that, I was like, oh, that is awesome. Got a lasso made of flame, and he's got a lasso made of flame, and the devil's going down in chains. Yes, he is. Yes, he is a cowboy. And when he gave me that chain, lasso made of chain, oh, yeah, I was like, yeah, man. But, I mean, Jesus is coming back, and as long as we trust in him, you know, we'll be up there. We'll be up there taking part in all this. And, you know, so Jesus is not the lamb anymore. He's coming back as the lion. And, you know, there's some examples of that. You know, the temple, when he made the whip and, you know, kicked everybody out. But, you know, a lot of people will say, oh, no, you know, as a Christian, you know, you're just supposed to accept, you know, how I want it to be. You're supposed to bow down to me, you know, and that's not right. You know, we're supposed to be wise as serpents and harmless as doves, but there comes a point to where you got to stand up, you know, and where, as you can see, you know, it's time, and there's this last election. We stood up, you know, and if we hadn't stood up, you know, things are still going down a slippery slope, you know, and as Christians, we can change, you know, Jesus, God said, hey, you know, if you pray, you know, I will heal your land. And, you know, obviously, you know, we have power in prayer. And, you know, if you know, they say America's 80% Christian nation, but if 80% of us got together and stood up, things would change. And that's what it's going to take, you know. Otherwise, but, you know, it's tough because we're supposed to resist the enemy and the devil will flee, James 4:7. So we're supposed to resist the enemy. That I get conflicted sometimes because we know, hey, if we just lift our hands up, said, all right, does that usher in Jesus any faster? If all the Christians said, okay, I'm done, you know, boom, boom, boom. But God didn't create us that way. I mean, I think God, you know, I think we're fighters, man. And, you know, God created us to serve him. And to do what's righteous and right. And just to, you know, to put our hands up and just say, hey, you know what, yeah, just do it. But, you know, so we're supposed to resist the enemy and he will flee. But as I'm watching Joshua worship God, you know, I started thinking that, you know, hey, now when's the last time you've gotten down on your face and worship the Lord, you know, and listen to him? Because right here at the end, you know, what does he say? He said, and Joshua did so. So he said, take your sandals off, for your place where you stand is holy. And Joshua did so. So Joshua did what God asked him to do. So how many times do we get down? Or how many times we just say, no, you know what, I hear you, Lord. But I'm not going to do what you asked me to do. You know, it's like I talked about last week, and I was hearing from the Lord and going and praying for, hey, man, go and pray for that person. You're struggling and fighting. You know, I remember in Alabama, one of the first times, there was a girl in there. I knew she had cancer. I was by myself in a restaurant. I was down there. We were serving the hurricane and Pastor Sean Bumpers. We served there at his place too. And I was just looking. I would get into this thing where I'd look and see if they had a bumper sticker on their car, you know, yeah, I love Jesus, or had a little shirt, and I couldn't tell, man. I know the Lord was telling me to go pray for this person. I went in the bathroom and was crying, and I came back out, and I just couldn't do it, man. I couldn't do it. So I went, and they were getting gas up the hill, and I got up, and Pastor D.A. and Sam Peake was like, man, you all right? I was like, yeah, I'm fine. And I should have said, and I later on I did, but I should have said, man, I need to go pray for this lady. Can y'all, you know, go and help me? Pray for me and let me go back down there. but I didn't do it. It was a missed opportunity. I was disobedient. You know, so who was I following at that point in time? You know, God gave me a commandment. I heard it. I just didn't do it. You know, wanted to do it, but I didn't do it. You know, that was a missed opportunity. But fortunately, you know, through God's grace, it's 180, turn and repent. The day, you know, you got a new day. And as I was sitting there thinking about this, and when he took his sandals off, you know, that was the, you know, we used to go to church. You know, what do? Yeah, tuck our shirts in. Yeah. Hats. And I'm not picking on Pastor Harry back there. Hats, because I've been wearing one lately. You know, hats, boom, off. You know, car doors, boom, honey. Is that a respect? You know? And so I was sitting there thinking, all right, when I've got a wood floor. So I'll walk in my house with my shoes. Man, this weekend, I just sweat. And I walked in there. Now, granted, I'm cutting wood and stuff, but I walk in there with my shoes just a couple times. I'm like, man, where did this come from? All right? I got dirt in my house. So, you know, God, he's telling them, hey, take off your shoes. So are we taking off our shoes? You know, when we walk in our house, spiritually speaking, you know, our house is a sanctuary, our wives, our kids, you know, what are we doing in our house? You know, is our house that holy ground, you know, that sanctuary? And I think we'd all probably have to say we're a little guilty of doing, you know, some of us may be really guilty of doing some things that we shouldn't be doing. And some of us, all of us are probably somewhat guilty. You know, a show we watch or music we listen to. You know, I was sitting there reminded that, you know, I was saved at 12 down in Goldsboro. I felt the Spirit. I got up. I went up. And it wasn't a few years later. You know, it's got to be careful about who you hang around. But a few years later, I remember sitting in my mom's Buick. And I love that thing. It had a 400 in it, man. And I personally put a stereo in it. Rocking. I remember sitting out in the church, got the tape that I hid out, popped it in, and what am I listening to in the church parking lot? Hell's Bells. Satan's waiting for you. Hell's Bells. In the church parking lot. You know? So, how did I go from that to now I'm worshiping Satan? Let's be quite frank. You know, the music that we listen to today. And Satan, hey, man, what was his job? He was a music worship leader. Don't think that he wasn't sitting there going, oh, yeah, yes, thank you. You know, he was accepting that praise where angels say, whoa, whoa, no, 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 do not do that. They saw what happened. You know, Lucifer, hey, he wanted that praise. You know, and he fell, and a third of them fell. And now you've got, you know, Jesus here who's accepting that. He said, because he can, because he's worthy. So, you know, I get back to, you know, I guess out of this, what I can get out of this is, you know, our houses. Are we taking our shoes off? You know, do we have the mezuzah? You know, how many times, I got a mezuzah. How many times we actually, every day, like you're supposed to, you know, or like the Israelites did, Jewish people do. You know, I got one. Every now and again, I see it, you know, but I'll know every day. And so, you know, I guess what I'm trying to say is that, you know, we all need to make sure that we're taking our shoes off when we come into the house, making sure we don't drag any dirt in, and making sure that while we're in the house with our kids and our wives, that we're doing godly things, you know, in our house, in our sanctuary. We got a sanctuary here, but that's where we live. And are we doing that? And if we're not, it's all right. We can turn. It's not all right, but we can still turn, repent, and then start a new day and start listening to other things. I know back in the day, most of all what I would listen to was, you know, Christian stuff. You know, and then the politics, I got caught up in the politics a little bit. And now, you know, now I'm starting to turn. You know, I mean, I listened to some stuff this morning, but, you know, so my goal is to kind of, I need to shut that politics stuff out and start listening to more teachings. That's what I used to, learning more about God. You know, and that's what I need. That's personally, that's what I need to start doing.